This episode goes out to Leighton in Algiers. Hi there, Garrett Robinson here. Welcome to the 9th episode of the Nightblade Epic Podcast, Season 2. Well, it's another Monday, but this one is special, because 3 days ago we revealed the next novel of Underrealm to the world. You can pre-order it right now at underrealm.net/TTK. The book is called A Cloak of Red by Brenna Gawain, and it's the first book in the 10th Kingdom series. This is a brand new series of Underrealm novels, starring Theron, one of the main characters of the Academy Journals and one of our most popular characters ever. This series has been in the works for 3 years, and we're beyond excited to finally reveal it to you now. Brenna Gawain is the first author, other than me, to have an Underrealm novel published, and it's a hell of a debut. Theron is a child from the streets who is given an opportunity to train at the Academy for Wizards and learn to use her magic. But that training came with a price, a life of servitude to a noblewoman who sees Theron as a possession. She gets a chance at freedom when she joins the Mystics, the same order of warriors as Jordel from the podcast, but now she finds herself pitched into a war for Underrealm's future and begins to discover secrets that could mean the death of everyone and everything she loves. A Cloak of Red comes out on April 10th, 2020, just a few short months away. Go place your pre-order now at underrealm.net/TTK. Pre-orders are a huge help to us. They help us gauge interest as well as market the series to new readers. So please, go to underrealm.net/TTK and pre-order today. Again, that's underrealm.net/TTK. Okay, now it's time for today's episode. Today, you're getting Chapter 12 of Mystic. When we left off, Lauren and her friends had been discovered by agents of the family Yeren as they hid inside a tavern in Redbrook. Enjoy! Mystic, Chapter 12.
"Those men are from my family," said Annis, her voice quaking.
"Are you certain?" said Lauren.
"I would wager much on it. They wear our colors. That mystic woman must have told Fortinbras about us after all."
Lauren saw something she had missed before, a small girl standing beside the men. Wasted and thin, with a large belly and giant eyes, she raised a finger to point at the window where they all stood. Lauren dropped to the ground a half moment before Zane, Jem, and Annis did the same, but not before they saw the Yeren men approaching the building.
"Cursed beggar rat," said Jem.
"Some children should learn when to keep their mouths shut."
Lauren avoided the obvious retort.
"We have to leave, now."
"Out the back," said Zane. "We shall have to leave the horses."
"I thought you meant to sell them to purchase supplies for our journey," said Annis. "How will we pay for food and lodging?"
"Would you like to stay behind and barter with your relatives?" said Zane. "We must leave them or be caught. Come."
He rose to a crouch and slunk to the doorway. Lauren hastened to follow, keeping Jem and Annis on either side of her. Together they slipped through the door, feet squishing in the discarded food with a meaty slurp.
"Is there a back staircase?" asked Lauren. "The front will take us into the common room, and they will find us."
"There is," said Zane. "I found it when I went to fetch our dinner."
Jem's stomach rumbled at the word and kept going as they ran down the hallway behind Zane. Lauren thought darkly of the meal they had missed. Poorly had they eaten upon the road, and their supplies had run low. She did not know how long the voyage to Wellmont might take, and she feared they would run out of food as they sailed, but there was nothing for it now. Zane led them down the corridor, which turned left twice before ending in a steep staircase. Lauren offered Annis a helping hand to keep her from tripping over her skirts as they descended to the stone floor of the inn's kitchen. A cook and two servants barely looked up as they walked hastily to a back door and stepped outside.
We could run blind, but I think it would be wiser to spend a few moments discouraging our pursuers, said Zane. He turned to Jem. Little master, can you ape your trick from today and abandon them in the alleys?
Of course, said Jem. Only take care to keep up. I cannot lead effectively if I am looking behind me at every corner.
Jem ran ahead, and they followed. The alley behind the inn was scarcely wide enough for two to walk abreast, and did not split before it reached the street. Jem burst out into the wide open space, and there ran straight into another man in a green waistcoat and trousers, who cried out in surprise. Jem stared up at the man in horror. Lauren took in the man's clothes in an instant, surely another agent of Yeren. She lunged forwards as he gawked in confusion. One foot darted behind the man's heel, and she gave his chest a great shove with both hands. The man tripped over her leg with a shout and crashed to the ground. His head hit the cobblestones hard, and he rolled, stunned, onto his side. But his shouts had roused others, and Lauren saw them emerge into the moon's light from side streets in every direction.
"Run!" she screamed.
Jem needed no further urging, and Lauren seized Annis's hand to yank the girl after them. Jem found another gap between buildings, and they slipped inside.
"Does Yeren pursue us with an army?" growled Zane. "Where did they all come from?"
"I knew we had a strong presence in Redbrook, but I did not think there were this many."
Annis's voice came quick between deep gasps for air.
"I would wager my cousin has hired more men to pursue us."
Lauren turned to Jem.
"Why do we not take to the rooftops? Could we lose them more quickly from above?"
"Look at them," cried Jem. "Thatch!"
Lauren saw his point. Cabras had had roofs of wood, shingle, tile, or stone. Some roofs here might hold them, but their feet might sink through others, and they could not know which would be safe.
"Then our only hope lies in reaching the docks," said Lauren. "Do not try to confuse them, Jem. If they know who we are, they know we visited Brimlad today. Get us there, quickly."
Jem swerved left without answer. From alley to street, narrow winding roads to gaps in wood fences, he ran with the scuttling pace of a mouse, never charging at full speed, but never slowing. Then, sudden as a thunderclap, they came to a dead end in a long alley. At the end was a wooden fence 4 paces high.
"Turn around!" cried Lauren.
But as she followed her own advice, she saw it was too late. 4 men skidded to a stop at the alley's mouth. Only one of them wore green and had Annis's dark skin, but all of them carried naked broadswords that glittered in the moon's light. Lauren thrust Jem and Annis behind her.
"Stop," said the man in green. "You are fugitives from the king's justice and will come with us."
Lauren looked around. They must have stopped near a brewery, for all around them stood tall stacks of empty wooden barrels with spigot holes punched in each.
"Zane, your fire!"
Lauren seized the bottom barrel of one stack and heaved as hard as she could. The stack wobbled but did not topple. Jem, seeing her intent, squeezed between the stack beside it, and together they heaved again. Barrels crashed to the ground, some shattering and sending their staves to scatter across the stones. Zane guessed at her aim and cried a word. His eyes glowed, fire flashed from his hands, and the line of fallen barrels burst into flame before them. The Yeren men cried out and shielded their eyes with their hands, backing away from the fearful heat.
"Up!" cried Lauren. "Quickly!"
"I said the roofs are no good," said Jem.
"We must risk them, or we are lost."
"There is another way," said Zane. Again he spoke words of magic, and his hands flashed with fire. A great ball of flame slammed into the fence with a crushing blow. Splinters flew as the fence burst. The blast nearly threw Lauren from her feet. Annis and Jem were cast to the ground. Zane seized Jem while Lauren took Annis, and together they fled through the burning hole while the Yeren men shouted and cursed behind them. Lauren heard a familiar murmur and looked ahead to see they were now very close to the river. But there at the docks stood another 4 men in Yeren colors, all of them armed and 2 wearing armor besides. The men looked up at their approach, and the air rang with the hiss of drawn steel.
"It looks like a fight,"
Though her stomach twisted, Lauren heard a strange calm in her own voice.
Annis and Jem, stay back and board Brimlad's boat at the first chance. If we are bested, sail away with him.
Spare us your paltry heroics, girl, said Zane with a growl. For a third time he spoke words Lauren could not understand, but no sparks blazed in his palms. Instead, he spread his arms wide, fingers splayed like a child stroking water on a riverboat. For a moment nothing happened, and Lauren thought his magic had failed him. Then a breeze kicked up, and dust and discarded straw swirled all around them. The breeze turned to a wind, and then a gale. Lauren pulled Jem and Annis to her side for fear they would blow away. But though the wind buffeted her with terrible strength, the men on the docks got it far worse. The wind slammed into them like a battering ram, flinging them screaming into the water. Zane closed his fingers, and the glow died in his eyes. The wind faded to nothing. Lauren could feel herself shaking. Everything she had seen from Zane seemed like parlor tricks next to the gale, and yet he had called forth the power in moments. What else was the wizard capable of? But even as she watched, Zane faltered as he tried to take a step forwards. Lauren took her arms from Jem and Annis and went to support him, lifting him up by one arm and helping him stand.
I am all right, said Zane. A moment's weakness only. Let us hurry before they surface and find their way back to the docks.
Together they stumbled and staggered their way to the docks, where they saw a line of boats still swaying in the swelling waters of the river, stirred by Zane's mighty storm. No sooner had they descended the steps and found Brimlad's skiff than the captain himself emerged from below decks, cursing mightily and squinting at them all in the meager light of a candle.
"What in the nine lands was that?" he barked. "It felt like a sea gale come from nowhere. I thought I would capsize."
"A little distraction for the imps who plague us, nothing more," said Zane. "But I am afraid circumstances have changed somewhat drastically. We must leave, Brimlad, and now. Certain parties seek an uncomfortable conversation we would rather avoid."
Brimlad scowled, and Lauren feared he might refuse them. But the captain's hesitation lasted only a moment, and then he ran to the boat's rear.
"You, boy! Are your arms as weak as they look?"
Jem started as he realized Brimlad was talking to him. His chest puffed up, and he stood straighter.
"I am strong enough to be a warrior, even if my mind is sharp as—"
"Be silent. Run to the bow and cast off the lines when I tell you to. You will find a pole there. Use it to keep us from hitting the dock as we leave."
Jem looked back and forth, taking a step in either direction.
Where is the bow?"
"The front of the ship, you imbecile!" roared Brimlad. "Scholar, indeed. Girl, get yourself below decks. I have no use for one as slim as you."
Lauren threw her shoulders back.
"I can help. I'm as tall as Zane and mayhap stronger."
"I meant the little one," said Brimlad, pointing to Annis and causing Lauren's cheeks to burn. "You I need. Join the boy at the bow and use the oar you will find there to keep our nose pointed the way I tell you. Have you ever rowed before?"
Lauren balked.
"No. We had no boats."
"We have no time for a speech," Brimlad bellowed. "Do as I say. You will learn the way of it soon, or we shall all be dead. Zane, can I count on your witchery?"
Lauren saw the wizard sag a bit.
"I am weary, but I will do what I can."
"We should not need much," said Brimlad. "Just enough to get us free and clear in the open water. Blow when I tell you to."
Zane nodded and went to stand beside the captain. Brimlad turned his sharp eyes on Lauren again and growled,
"What are you still doing here, girl? I sent you to the bow."
Lauren leaped to comply. Once she reached the front of the boat, Brimlad shouted for Jem to cast them off. Another breeze began to gather, and when Lauren glanced back, she could see the glow of Zane's eyes in the night. Behind them, as they floated away from the dock, a party of men reached the stone wall that bordered the river. One slight, foolish man thought the distance not too great. He leaped at them, but missed the boat by 2 paces to land in the water.
"Girl," cried Brimlad, "steer us to port.
That means row on the right side."
Lauren had forgotten about the oar. She quickly found it lying on the deck and seized it, thrusting it into the water on the right side of the boat with a splash. She pulled until her arms burned and, to her surprise, saw the skiff's nose turning easily beneath her. When Brimlad called at her to stop, she did, and the boat coasted gently upriver. When they drifted too near the dock and the other boats, Jem pushed them away with his pole, and as the shouts of the Yeren men faded behind them, they slipped out upon the water and through Redbrook's western river gate with hardly a sound. A true wind rose as they sailed into the darkness, and Zane ceased his magic with a relieved sigh. The wizard slumped against the boat's railing. Brimlad lashed the tiller and went to unfurl another sail. Lauren watched as the shore passed with gathering speed.
"You are done, girl," said Brimlad. "If I need your help steering now, I am no fit captain for even a rusted barrel."
Lauren dropped the oar and went to sit facing Zane. Annis poked her head out from below decks and then emerged when she saw the danger had passed.
"Well, I do not know what we were worried about," said Lauren. "I have had closer calls than that."
"Long waters stretch between us and Wellmont," said Zane, "and closer calls we may yet have before they end. Do not tempt fate, for she can be wily."
"She has been wily enough for a lifetime recently," said Jem. "Yet we have been wilier still," said Lauren, "and will remain so."
Zane snorted, but said nothing.
This has been a production of Legacy Books, written and narrated by Garrett Robinson. The music in this podcast was created by Will Musser. Check out his incredible work at willmusser.com. That's willmusser.com. Today's letter is S. Thank you for listening. Bye-bye.